Okay. As part of the, this is the only property that I know of that the Conservation Commission has that has, or that the town or land trust has, that has a management plan. We wrote a management plan as part of the requirement to get it from DEM. This area back here, where these trees are, we mow that every so many years to keep it a field. And we didn't cut the trees because we wanted to leave the trees because they're so nice. But it actually runs over that way to a fence which separates Mostowski's property from the town property.
So when should that get mowed again?
We're going to probably mow it again shortly, yeah. The sign was put up in 1984, 85, and that's how it looks after that many years. So it's actually done very well.
Did you build this one?
We're going to redo it, yeah. Barr Wharton built that sign.
Oh, Barr did.
And Barr painted it. Evelyn Rhodes did the logo.
It's pretty good.
We're going to change it all to vinyl. I think what we'll do is we'll take it apart and change it all to vinyl. Take Evelyn's logo and change it to vinyl, so it'll come out real nice.
Oh, it looks great.
Well, so we had a natural.
Well, the land trust, is they helped it. They bought the first mower that we used in here. So that's why
they did. Chris, did you say when the town bought it?
It was in 83, 84. Oh, I think it's an engine. Guys, don't tell me on the phone. Changed a lot in the last, well, since 85, 86. Wow. These were put in back then also. I made those years ago and they're still there. When we first put this trail in, we walked through it and we flagged it and it was very dense, just like this. And I said, we gotta cut the trail. And I said to Bob Sutton, what do we have to cut it? He had an old mower that the town had. It was a rotary mower with a blade that stuck out about this far in the front. He didn't want to let me use it, and he finally said, okay, you can use it. And it was a beast. But it actually, I walked right through stuff like this.
Just
cut everything.
You go both ways here, right?
Technically not.
Isn't it wet somewhere?
Yeah, well. The original, this is the original trail. Uh-huh. And what happened was that the guy, when we would bring the mower in, we'd bring the big tractor in, which Steve Geisel used to drive the big tractor, and he'd mow all the field down here, which I'll show you. Once we put this boardwalk in, because it was so wet, and actually we got a DEM grant to do this, and we put all these boardwalks in because it was very wet here. Once we put it in, he couldn't run the tractor over it. So we created an opening there. And the idea was to let that grow back and just drive over it and not cut anything, and people start using it. So it's not really a formally part of the trail.
So this kind of boardwalk's okay? Yeah. Why wouldn't we have one of these going?
Mike,
because this was done in the 80s.
Right, this kind of boardwalk
was
okay then. It's not okay now.
It's not okay now. What do you use now?
They want it 3 feet high.
Are you serious?
Yeah.
That's kind of, and that
one's even acceptable then?
Let light go under.
Why 3 feet high?
To let water flow underneath. That's the problem.
But I think these are really nice.
Hull Cove right away proposal is that.
All right, did we bring the chainsaw?
Is there another way to build it without?
Wouldn't it be nice just to have this height? This is logical, as opposed to 3 feet in the air.
You can do it, but it's a lengthy permitting process.
Oh, my word.
So we worked with them.
Seems like Chris.
Yeah. Well, I worked
this
with
is why I wanted you guys to fund me a chainsaw.
The Nature Conservancy is building a little Compton. No, it's not going to be quite that high. They got permission. It's like
with the town. Just as an example, though, for a second. Wouldn't the town just come take care of it?
No.
Why not?
If we asked them to do it, we'd just have to make them.
You think that's their? You'd say, hey guys, there's a tree down, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah,
so what I would
put Mike Gray
on his list. That'd be the easier way to do it.
Yeah, exactly.
I think it'd probably be better for the town if it's on town property that the town employee do it rather than us volunteers and cutting your arm off.
I'm on that side of things where you just call it in and say, hey, we were walking a trail.
Michael, I can tell you from my experience, it doesn't always happen that quick.
Well. No, I know that.
You don't want volunteers to do it unless they know what they're doing.
Right.
Did you stage like a deer or a bear back in here for us today?
Moose.
Actually, a cow.
Yeah, we got him off the bridge.
Okay, the property was divided. It was 35 acres originally. We bought it through a grant with DEM and the town pays for some of it, I think, or matched. But it goes up to the golf course there. This is the only real, quote, mature part of the area. And the golf course starts back where you can see the light. All the things you see, the improvements of the area, have been done by scout projects. That was an Eagle Scout project.
Charming.
So.
Who labeled the trees, Chris?
The latest labels, those were done by, what's his name? Yeah, it's tree committee.
Jim Rue?
Jim Rue. I think Jim gave us the little signs and he either gave them to us or he put them on. I can't remember now. Or both. Okay. This trail doesn't take a lot of maintenance except trimming the sides and cutting trees and things like that for falling. It's actually been used quite a bit. Great for cross-country skiing.
Yeah. And I pedaled in here in a mountain bike before too. It's wide enough to get the pedal through. You know?
You'll see later on the center area has all been mowed and it needs to be mowed again. And Mike said he'd let us, you know, he'd bring the tractor in this year and do it. But I usually like to wait till after the wildlife has quieted down.
So you're not supposed to ride bike in here? That,
you know, no motorized vehicle. Entrance to the golf course. So the people, when they cross country ski, they can ski in the golf course and come through here and ski the Sanctuary Trail. And Joe started putting his plugs there when they plug the land. So we got a pile of plugs there. So it would be nice to get that cleared again so you could get in easily. But we put a cut in the wall there just so people could get through there with skis. But Joe uses kind of that corner of the property to store plugs, which when he plugs the ground for aeration. Yeah. What? Pretty clear. Yeah, as long as you can get through there with a set of skis, it's not bad.
Does that need a little sign?
The other real good group to get are the scouts. The scouts are always looking for service projects, so we can get them in here periodically to do mowing and or cutting rather. But they have to trim with hand tools.
Not on
this property. There's water, there's a spring. If you go up on the golf course and walk parallel to the stone wall which borders this property, there's a spring right there.
There are significant freshwater wetlands that are mostly, best I can tell, road runoff and some natural wetlands that I can show you. They were actually flagged recently, so we can point that out when you turn the corner. And that's been the... That's right. And that's been where the fragmites I'll show you when we get out there. We're talking about that
Yeah,
absolutely.
That was part of it. Doing.
Good luck.
Over to your left over here, there's another area that we mow also. We pick certain areas to kind of keep mowed. So that needs to be mowed again, but that's the only place I've ever seen a natural beehive in the island. There's an old tree back there that had its own beehive in it. Oh. It was really cool. Years ago.
You don't hear any wild turkeys on the property?
No.
No
wild turkeys on Jamestown that we know of, yeah.
I was going to say, you see them on the other side of the bridge.
As soon as you get over there.
Yeah, there have been some, Chris.
Are there not?
Oh, good. They've
never noticed
here.
They weren't here.
We don't have a lot of
things out here.
This was the first project. This was Ken, one of the Froberg kids did this boardwalk years and years and years ago. This is the first overlook. There's three overlooks on the property. This one we kept low because really we didn't want to put the, we were going to put a platform here, but we wanted to elevate it. And CRMC said, or DEM, I can't remember now, said they didn't want it elevated. So we found a high spot. So the platform you're going to see next is on the high spot.
There's one that way, right?
Yeah, that's the other way.
This is the Jamestown postcard right here.
Yeah.
The marsh
you'll
and
see
the
it.
Farm. There's so many beautiful views, you know?
And you can see... I'm sorry, Karen.
No, go ahead.
All the stakes in the marsh, those are all the stakes we use for monitoring. There's a well next to each one of those.
When we get to
what are you measuring, Chris?
You'll see it better at the next
one. At the next couple of platforms.
The next platform, you'll see it better.
This is a good example of a really healthy
water. We have some pipes we put in the ground that we measure salinity and water level. Right. Part of that project.
Is the Coast and Geodetic Service?
NRCS. They're the ones that are funding that project.
I see.
They're the one that gave the town $60,000 to do the marsh restoration.
So this does okay.
Yeah,
and this is a little bit drier, so there's less fresh water coming in here. You'll see on the other side where we have problems with Phragmites is where there's a lot of fresh water coming
fresh water,
in from the upland side.
So is the project to basically open up the marsh so the salt water can get further?
That's right.
You'll see better from the next platform.
Yeah, I can explain.
The other thing that happened here, which was really interesting when we first got the property, was when it was set up for house lots, there's a bunch of perk pipes. We've taken all of them out, but a few. It was like 11 house lots here. And then there was a golf course proposed. Golf course, not a golf course, a hotel, huge hotel.
What year was that?
That was in the early 80s, too.
Who owned the property?
Bill Bergen did the design for the hotel, and a guy named Ray Bernardo, who owned the George's at Galilee, he owned the whole property. It's called the Bernardo property.
Yeah, I know these kids.
And what had happened before he bought it, they had actually cut a lot of the trees, and they had bulldozed for the development, and they created a big berm here. So what you find back in the woods here is a freshwater wetland, because it's all been bermed up and the water sits there. So there was all kinds of neat freshwater wetland plants, you know, not standing water, but well, there's standing water, but more of a just a wet soil. And then it went up the hill. So we'd mowed a lot of that for years because they had some interesting plants in there.
Yeah.
It just got out of hand. But that's why these little mounds of dirt are around. Anybody does geocaching, there's a box right behind the street.
Hide it very well.
One of the few places on the island that has a lot of really nice gray birch. See a lot of gray birch here.
As we come down here, these blue flags were the delineated wetland edge when we were trying to get the all the hydrological information for the marsh restoration. Mm-hmm. So this is where wetland comes right up into here. Goes up into about where the cedars
tree comes
are.
Down. Birch is just flattened under there. I mean, flattened. Yeah. Like, okay.
Oh my gosh, you did that, Carol. Jim Turin did it in December, a couple years ago.
I left the top.
They're still there. That's amazing.
One birch is alone.
I get my lockers out apparently. Land Trust bought a mower for us. It was a sickle bar mower. People know what that looks like. And I kept it in my house for like 10 years, and we used to mow it about every week. And it shows you what happened over the years. Finally, we got really nice trails.
Yeah,
a little more erosion.
Require any maintenance
now. No, it all looked like that. We had to mow it almost every week for years during the growing season.
I don't know. I'm still thinking
it's really good.
I don't know how. It's not all that heavily.
Yeah.
My experience.
Yeah.
So the Christmas grant plate requirement is not only helpful location for mowing and a path of trail.
Yeah, so that's what I'm looking at.
Broken right off.
No, it's an Eagle Scout project that was right back in there. So I told him to move it down there, and he never moved it.
Lovely place to bring a sandwich and hang out.
Yeah. It's great. No, I mean, I'll tell you what.
This is
it's
the first.
Unbelievable. Oh, yeah, especially for this.
Yeah, side. This is the first platform that was built here. Bob Sutton, myself, Bar Wharton, and there was one other person I can't remember who's. We built this years ago, but it's on a hill. You'll notice. That's why Coastal let us put it here. We found a high spot, and they let us put it here. And you guys pay to keep this cut in front of here. In fact, what's the name? Greg's supposed to come in and cut that for us again. But here's a good example. You can see where the Phragmites is marching across the marsh where it can.
Yeah, these guys? Actually, if you jump up a little bit higher, you can see the deepest part, the natural creek that comes in,
yeah.
And how much salt water does come up. And then you can see an area like this where you get the real tall frag right next to you, so it's getting lots of fresh water and oxygen, and then it just sends runners out. Okay. So those smaller plants are connected to these larger ones, so they're growing out in an area that's primarily salt inundated, but they send the oxygen and water down through the runners to be able to tolerate conditions they otherwise wouldn't.
Yeah.
Then when it dies, it's very persistent, builds up biomass really quickly, so it falls, so it actually raises the elevation under itself.
Oh, so self-perpetuating.
And before you know it, it gets fresher and fresher. And
But there isn't any out in here. It looks like it's pretty clear.
No, you'll see it. You'll
area,
see it.
When we get to the next platform, if you look kind of behind me, you got to sort of be up high. You can see real tall frag, so that's where it's all coming out.
Oh, yeah,
so that's the main site the restoration is going to focus on.
So how far in are you going to cut channels?
You'll see. The next platform will give you a good look. A couple of great egrets still out here, not yet headed south.
You can kayak right up this creek all the way up almost to the bridge and turnpike. It's really nice. Really at high tide, yeah. It's very nice. It's sharp-tailed sparrows. Is it sharp-tailed? Yeah, sharp-tailed sparrows.
Yep.
A lot of interesting stuff out here. In fact, there's a lot of egrets around, which is really late.
It is really late.
There are about 12.
There's 10 of them there.
That's
right.
The birds are dumb.
They're
sensible
creatures.
Areas like this, you know, this platform, actually, we probably should get some in and pressure wash it. They did the one you'll see at the Kitt-Wright Trail, and that's what we should do to this one. Somebody actually tried to have a campfire here one years ago.
Is that what that is?
Dead standing. The platform is burned. Hey, little things on the front of the platform are for putting a tripod on.
Is that what those are?
You put the front leg of a tripod.
Try that. There.
Hey, Chris, when they do the BioBlitz, are they going to come to this area?
Yeah, the BioBlitz will cover, this will be part of it, the whole marsh, the sanctuary property, and then I'll show you from there and then all the way up to East Elwood Avenue.
They can do insects, too.
Yeah, everything. Everything.
So, Chris, when I see people clamming and coming way up in here, is that what they're, are you supposed to be doing that or not?
Yeah.
You see people in there all the time.
You know, if they have a permit or they have, you know, license to clam or whatever.
It's
not closed. It's not closed for pollution.
It isn't? Okay.
No, it's Audubon property, but anything below mean high water, and that's something to remember. The property across the street from the bait shop, it's privately owned by the woman that lives on the corner there, or part of it is, and she's always chasing people off. And what we had to remind people that if you're in the tall Spartina alternate flora, which is, see the tall one around the edges of the creeks? That's flooded by the tide. So that's not mean high water. You can stand in there, but you can't stand on this side of it. This side of it would be private property. Mean high water would be that alternate flora meets pay tents.
So who owns?
Private on the other side of the road. This right here is all owned by the town.
This town owns all
the town. So this is part of the golf course and sanctuary property up to the creek. And then the back side of the creek up to the Neal Farm is an Audubon Society of Rhode Island refuge.
The interpretive sign, the Conservation Commission did these. We've got one here. We've got one at the Kitt-Wright Trail. What's your name? Alexander Kent put the drawings for us. I designed the sign and did the interpretive work. We got one more of these down in the basement of the town hall, and that's the one that's planned to go over at the water treatment plant. And we put that platform in. And probably what we should do, this one we're going to have to move. I put it here because it was the most obvious place to put it, but you don't want to face these things south. The sun just kills them. So it really should be over there where Mike is standing. One day I'll get my bolt and wrench.
Your cordless drill with it?
No, I just get wrenches too. But no. They've actually held up very well. That's been here probably 10, 15 years.
It looks great, natural again.
Now, the Phragmites is actually topped and cut periodically? Or?
No.
You'll see, when we get to the next platform, you can get a really good look at what the problem is.
No, I'm sorry, we cut this, Ted. We try to cut in front of the platform for the view, and it hasn't been cut. At least he reaches it with a long pair of cutters.
Right. So how quickly does the Phragmites create its progression?
So you can look at aerial photographs going back to the back to the 70s when the bridge was built, and you can see it just steps out. It's not fast.
As a kid, he remembers when that was open in there, and he said this marsh was totally different.
Just from the construction of that roadway.
He said this end of the marsh was totally different. He said, it used to be really wild, and here it used to be really beautiful. That's what he remembers as a kid. He's probably with his 50.
What would it take to open up that culvert?
Well, the pipe is there, but that's, what it is probably...
Who's going in? You want to go in?
We actually explored that when we started the restoration proposal as one of the first things.
Yeah, to put it in as one of the...
And it's just not possible. It would be tearing up the road and redesigning the whole thing. There's no way
It's either collapsed or totally plugged.
You want to get the whole commission?
It wasn't properly designed, Chris. It was never designed to do that.
Let's go to the next. That's what we should be doing with all of them. Anytime we replace something now, we ought to replace it with plastic. If we can afford it, makes a huge difference. This is another Eagle Scout project.
All this recycled stuff. This would be where all the bags from Rhode Island's bag program are going into this kind of stuff.
There's a thing on the platform too.
It's amazing stuff. It just lasts.
When we first...
Slippery.
It is slippery.
When we first got this property, none of this frag was here.
So this is where, so this is freshwater wetland, and this is what drains right out into the marsh. You can see the light behind it is where it changes. So this is tall, healthy Phragmites. This is like Phragmites like it wants to be.
Right. None of this was here when we first got the sanctuary. In fact, right here was a pond, an open water pond, which has totally been inundated by frag.
And that's all, and that's because of the road work? Or?
Because of increased freshwater coming in, and because Phragmites is an invasive that really likes disturbance.
Carol, so how deep is the root system in frag?
When you do construction for roadways and stuff, it just takes off.
What's the question? Mike, how deep the root system is for frag?
I don't know how far down you have to go.
It's like bamboo, you said it goes down and over and up again.
3 or 4 feet, I would think, to really get it. But you also have to compost. The rhizomes, you can't leave them in place, and if you chop it up, they'll just propagate. Yeah, it's an extremely aggressive plant.
Now, when we wanted to put another platform in the sanctuary, we had to find a place to do it, and we didn't need to fill. What I found out was this right here. You'll see this big flat stone. This is a bridge, and at one time there was a cart path, and what you walk on here is a path. It's an elevated area that was put in by the farmer. They used to go out and get hay out of the marsh, you know, hay being Phragmites, and being salt hay, right. And this is an elevated place. And we found this elevated spot. We went to Coastal and we said, this is where we want to put the trail. And they said, that's fine. But this bridge is all collapsed. And that's part of the reason why, what Carol was talking about earlier, that the fresh water is just inundated and not going out fast enough. So something we should do is probably rebuild this bridge so the water can get in and out again.
It still runs underneath.
Yeah, it still runs, but it's pretty collapsed. You see the water running here. It's just dropping in.
The causeway goes straight across the marsh over to the Niels property. If you're out there, you can find where the
I think that restoration is going to come up almost up to here somewhere.
It is.
This is one of the dishes.
It won't cross this path, but it'll come up to that.
Why not?
2003. This is the last platform. And the nice thing about this one is that the upper part of the marsh, we also now with the new osprey pole here, the birds on it last year and the year before, it's a nice place for people to watch the birds. And this is where most of the restoration is going to impact.
Yeah, Carol? So this is where you try to take out.
So you're going to try to get rid of these? By just changing the water or by getting rid of them physically?
A little bit of both, mostly just changing the water. This project, we opted to petition NRCS to not use herbicides. Phragmites is not salt tolerant, so if you get enough salt water on it, it will go by itself. Takes a little longer to do it that way. It's not quite the quick, pretty, like, oh look, it's done, you know, restoration complete. But it's effective in the long term. So the creek that we were looking at before, that natural creek, actually comes all the way up and then straight through the edge of this Phragmites, going all the way back to the road, is a historic mosquito ditch. And that's what's gotten plugged up. So that's just filled in over time. The Phragmites has grown out. It's grown right into the ditch. You can't even see where the ditch was. So essentially what the proposed restoration involves is just clearing out that ditch, clearing out a ditch that comes up to that little bridge where we were a few minutes ago, and then adding a new channel that cuts through this Phragmites that'll bring some of that salt water up here. And it's never gonna get rid of it entirely, but what it'll do is keep it from advancing out into the marsh further.
So would it make a physical barrier?
It's essentially like a firewall.
Yeah,
you're essentially bringing salt water in, and what it will do is reduce the height in a lot of cases, probably. It's not going to eradicate it. You'll always have Phragmites, and there's no point trying to get rid of it. But it'll hopefully thin it out, pull it back a little bit, and reduce the height so that you don't have it keep walking out further.
Okay.
Its height would be reduced because its nurturing solution is not.
That's
optimal.
Right. So the Phragmites that we just walked through back on there, that was about 20 feet high, you can see this is quite a bit lower. So this is stunted. And if you go further out in the marsh on the salt edges, it's really stunted because it's not getting the nutrients that it needs.
Salt water really does that to it, yeah, if you can get it in there. Yeah, so. Yeah. There used to be, back in this corner here, a really nice little freshwater marsh with cattails, mm-hmm. and that's kind of gone now. So there are things that have changed dramatically, and that's part of the purpose of this whole thing.
What you can't see all that well, but you can see a little opening kind of right here on the other side. There are still some remnants of salt hay and some little pans in here that get heavily used by ducks. And these are really what have been lost. The Phragmites is just kind of coming in from all sides.
They know what a pan is. It's
so
opening
watch,
in the marsh.
It's just a shallow, flooded area.
So the Phragmites outcompetes the cattails, is that it?
Yeah.
Phragmites, neck and neck. It kind of depends on the situation.
Yeah,
there wasn't
here.
A lot of cattail here. No. You'll still see some on the edges of the marsh over there. There's actually cattail back in that corner there.
Yep.
In this case, Phragmites has done better. Phragmites is more salt tolerant than cattails sometimes. Mm-hmm. Grows faster outward. The rhizome structure, the way this stuff works, it'll actually fall down on the edges and then just shoot out. I mean, it's really very aggressive.
Have there ever been any little localized fires in this?
No, not that I know. I know they use fire to control frag, but it really burns like crazy. It's really hard to control.
It's actually a fire hazard.
Black smoke, too, yeah.
The fire department over Bonnet Shores did a lot of frag restoration because of fire hazard concerns more than
huge fire hazard. Burns
I was wondering the same thing, Ted. Yeah. It was a way to control burns.
The other reason for this platform was that this was the first leg of the Kinnick Island Greenway. The Greenway, as proposed, is going to go from here. This is going to open up right here. That would open up, and it would be a boardwalk across the marsh. This is if it happens. The town actually bought the property across the way. You see all the tall trees there? Mm-hmm. That's the Preece property, P-R-E-E-C-E, I think. Bob was smart enough at one time when it came for sale, he bought that. And that property now will connect us to Eden Lane easily. In addition, we also have an easement along the side of George Neal's farm for the,
right.
That's where the trail will be.
So the cedar tree you see sticking up in the fence floor, that's the bottom side of George's property. So that's the base of his field. So it's right this long tree line right on this side.
But what we have to do is we have to go into the Preece property with the trail for a little ways and then come over, because of the easement's only granted on that far farm field, and then come through the wall, then go along the wall. So there's a path
across,
for it.
To get across a stretch of salt marsh like this would require an elevated walkover.
This
structure.
Would be definitely an elevated.
Then you want 3 feet.
Well, it makes sense there.
Yeah,
makes sense.
Yeah. So it's very doable. This platform was put in by Bar Wharton and his stepson, an Eagle Scout, Stephen Walsh, his stepson, and they put it in with an A-frame of like 2x12s and a rope and a pulley and a big thing like this that fit over the top of a 4x4 with a bunch of pieces of lead on top.
To pound it down.
They just drove it up, dropped it, drove it up, dropped it. They put all these pilings in. They're in about 4 feet without any effort at all. I mean, it took effort, but it was a lot easier. No impact to the marsh. Walked out here and did it. And the only problem we had when we first put it was the frag was coming through the deck, and then good old Jennifer
Gentilancy
came in here and put mesh underneath it, so now it can't grow through the deck anymore. Huh. So we kept it.
You know what the best part about this is? Just you can hear all those birds.
Except for the road.
And whose tree stand is that? There's like a deer.
That's a deer stand that George Neal has allowed somebody to hunt from there. But I'll tell you, it's a great place to photograph the occupant.
I was just gonna talk about it.
But you gotta get his permission.
That's exactly what I was thinking. Yeah, they're not shooting the
occupant. I've been up in the tree stand. Yeah.
Are there drainage streams coming in from this farm?
No, they actually have, they did an NRCS EQIP plan for all of their waste treatment and everything there. So the lower half of the whole field along that freshwater edge on George's property now has a buffer in place that gets mowed just once a year. Best we know,
we're going to have to clear a little area there, which is not a problem because it's pretty much just ratty old trees anyway that are in bad shape. And then the other thing we have to do is we need a dewatering and a composting area. So we'll probably come through the woods back there with a wide enough path they can get a piece of equipment. And then up in the sanctuary where we've mowed, we'll create an area for composting, which will actually be just mowed down later or removed later.
So a couple of you asked about...
it has to be on site somewhere.
Plans, yeah. Part of the challenge to doing any of this marsh work is that it takes low pressure equipment. And most of that is fairly small. So it's trying to get materials out of the marsh that's the complicated part.
Without ripping it all up.
Yeah, so you're working with this little, you know, little tiny bulldozer that has, you know, little tiny marsh-sensitive dump trucks and things, and then you got to do something with it. So those are the parts that really
make
it.
We get the Air National Guard to do some training.
I actually have a friend who's been working on National Grid to donate. They have big construction mats that make it easier to get in and out of the marsh without impact. So we're working on some of those.
But we still need a composting area, and it's got to be closed for
how many yards and stuff are you talking about
for compost?
NRCS has not provided design plans. They're supposed to have them.
How big the marsh is, I should know. So the property goes all the way to Eldred Avenue practically. So it's all been preserved, this whole Center Island area. It's huge. It's a great feat.
Bunch of scouts.
And they were this big. In the 80s, so all of that, we planted that batch right there just to give us sort of
who
a...
Who did it?
Forever. Elena Calderon lives up in the North End. She was on the commission, oh Lord, 20 years ago. We planted with the scouts. There's a little patch of them right there that just kind of gives a little bit of a different,
contextual. You'll see the difference in the vegetation here in the field, and then the area we're going to walk through right now is much drier. So this is on the upland side of that wetland delineation. So the very backside, you know, out of sight here is probably what we'll propose for composting. The materials that come out of the marsh.
Well, we'll mow that again, and it'll go back to a field, and it's better for certain birds.
It's actually not that far.